This video is based on an article originally printed in Advance magazine and was written by Curtis A. Parvin, Ph.D., John Yundt-Pacheco, and Max Williams. A link to the original article is provided in the video description. In the current healthcare climate, patients, providers, and regulators are increasingly focused on putting the patient at the center of all issues related to healthcare. The clinical laboratory provides much of the data used by healthcare providers to make diagnostic and therapeutic decisions about their patients. Consequently, the clinical laboratory often plays a pivotal role in determining the overall quality of patients' care. One of the laboratory's major impacts on quality of care is related to the reliability of the test results they produce and report. Laboratories use quality control, QC, procedures to assure the reliability of the test results they produce and report. According to ISO 15189, the International Organization for Standardization's document on particular requirements for quality and competence in medical laboratories, the laboratory shall design internal quality control systems that verify the attainment of the intended quality of results. That is, laboratory QC procedures should assure that the test results reported by the lab are fit for use in providing good patient care. The primary tool used by laboratories to perform routine QC is the periodic testing of QC specimens, which are manufactured to provide a stable analyte concentration with a long shelf life. A laboratory establishes the target concentrations and analytic imprecision for the analytes in the control specimen assayed on their instruments. Thereafter, the laboratory periodically tests the control specimens and applies QC rules to the control specimen results to make a decision about whether the instrument is operating as intended or whether an out-of-control error condition has occurred. Traditionally, laboratories determine how many control specimens to test and what QC rules to use based on a desire to have a low probability of making the erroneous decision that the instrument is out of control, when it is, in fact, operating as intended, and a high probability of making the correct decision that the instrument is out of control when indeed an out-of-control error has occurred. Clearly, the in-control or out-of-control status of a laboratory's instruments influences the reliability, quality, of the patient results reported by the lab. Laboratories tend to design QC strategies with a focus limited to controlling the state of the instrument rather than controlling the risk of producing and reporting unreliable patient results that could compromise patient care. One approach that more directly focuses on the quality of patient results rather than the state of the instrument is to design QC strategies that control the expected number of unreliable patient results reported because of an undetected out-of-control error condition in the lab. What do we mean by an unreliable patient result? The quality of a patient result depends on the difference between the patient specimen's true concentration and the value reported by the laboratory. We define an unreliable patient result as one where the difference between the patient specimen's true concentration and the value reported exceeds a specified total allowable error, TEA. If the error in a patient's result exceeds TEA, we assume it places the patient at increased risk of experiencing a medically inappropriate action. How does a laboratory decide what the TEA specification for an analyte should be? This is not a simple question to answer, but a number of different lists of TEA specifications that include hundreds of analytes have been produced and are available from a variety of sources. One example are the quality specifications found in the QC Documents section at www.qcnet.com. Once a TEA for an analyte has been specified, then for any possible out-of-control state, the probability of producing patient results with errors that exceed the TEA can be computed, as demonstrated in here. The gray curve represents the frequency distribution of measurement errors for an instrument operating as intended. The distribution is centered on zero, and the width of the distribution reflects the inherent analytical imprecision of the instrument. The black curve represents the frequency distribution of measurement errors after a hypothetical out-of-control error condition has occurred. The out-of-control error condition causes the instrument to produce results that are too high. The area under the out-of-control measurement error distribution that is either greater than TEA or less than negative TEA, shaded in red, reflects the probability of producing an unreliable patient result. In this case, 10% of the area under the curve is shaded red. If an out-of-control error condition of this magnitude occurred, then while the instrument was operating in this state, we'd expect 10% of the patient results produced to be unreliable. The expected number of unreliable patient results reported while an undetected out-of-control error condition exists will not only depend on the likelihood of producing unreliable results in the presence of the error condition, but also on how many patient results are produced before the error condition is detected and corrected. Let's look at an illustration of this point. The horizontal axis represents time. Each vertical line represents a patient specimen being tested on the instrument. Each diamond represents a QC event where QC specimens are tested and QC rules are applied. A green diamond implies the QC results are accepted. A red diamond means the QC results are rejected. At a point between the second and third QC event, an out-of-control error condition occurs, causing a sustained shift in the testing process. Given the magnitude of this particular out-of-control condition and the power of the QC rules, the error condition isn't detected until the third QC event after it occurred. Each red asterisk denotes an unreliable patient result that was produced during the existence of the out-of-control error condition. Notice some of the important relationships between QC events, the number of patients tested between QC events, and the number of unreliable patient results. Not all the results produced during an error condition are unreliable. The probability of producing an unreliable result during an error condition increases with the magnitude of the error. QC events do not always detect an error condition on the first try. The probability of a QC event detecting an error condition depends on the error detection rate of the QC rule, the number of control samples used, and the magnitude of the error. If the error condition in the example was smaller, we would expect proportionally fewer of the results tested during the undetected error condition to be unreliable, but more QC events needed to detect it. Conversely, if the error condition in the example was larger, we would expect proportionally more of the results tested during the undetected error condition to be unreliable, and fewer QC events needed to detect it. If the error condition were large enough, all of the patient test results after its occurrence would be unreliable, and it would almost certainly be detected at the first QC event. QC thinking that focuses on the instrument is concerned with the likelihood that a QC rule will trigger an alert after an error condition has occurred, in this example, the probability of a red diamond. Instrument-focused QC strategies are designed to control the number of QC events required to detect an error condition. QC thinking that focuses on the patient, on the other hand, is concerned with how many unreliable patient results are produced while an undetected error condition exists, in this example, the number of red asterisks. Patient-focused QC strategies should be designed to control the number of unreliable patient results produced before the error condition is detected. For all your laboratory QC needs, go to www.qcnet.com.